Chapter 12. I spent part of the night reading the book of quotes. I should have been resting, but I felt disturbed. More and more I thought of how easily I could turn the radio telescope at the observatory into a Z-space transmitter. The idea of contacting my parents filled me with sadness and longing. They could tell me what to do, I thought. They could give me instructions. And in another part of my mind, I thought, wouldn't they be proud that I was fighting on against the Yerks? They would all say, he's another Alfangor, a hero. I'm not proud that I was thinking that, but I have to tell the truth. And the truth was, I wanted everyone back home to think I was being very brave all alone on Earth. Already in my mind, a plan was taking shape. I found a quiet place and prepared to sleep. I closed my main eyes, leaving only my stalk eyes open to look for danger. I relaxed my tail until it touched the ground. Lonely. Yes, it was lonely to sleep in a forest on a planet far from home. It was lonely to be the only one of my kind. It was lonely knowing that Cassie was asleep in her home, and Marco in his, and Rachel and Jake. All had homes. All but me. And Tobias. Tobias. He would understand. But would he help me? And if I did what I was planning, would he help? And could I trust him? I raised my tail and opened my main eyes. I knew the place where Tobias slept. I found him easily. He stood with his sharp talons wrapped around a branch. Tobias? I called. Huh? What? Axe? What's the matter? Nothing is the matter, but I have a question. I hope it's a good one. I was sleeping. Tobias, are you my friend? That's what you woke me up to ask? He opened his wings and seemed to be stretching. Axe, we are the two strangest creatures on this planet. A freaky four-eyed half-deer, half-scorpion, centaur-looking alien, and a bird with the mind of a person. We've fought side by side. We've been nearly killed several times. Of course I'm your friend. It surprised me that he would answer so quickly, as if there was never any doubt what the answer would be. That's good, I said. Will you keep a secret, even from Prince Jake? Even from Rachel? Tobias was silent for a while. Is it something that would hurt my friends? No. Then I'll keep the secret, Tobias said. I swear. What do you swear by, Tobias? I have to be sure. What promise would you never break? Axe, you know I was there when your brother was killed. Yes, I know. You were the last one to leave him. Yeah, I don't know why, Tobias said. But something about him... I can't explain it, but I was drawn to him. I wanted to listen to him. I wanted to hear everything he had to say. It was like he was a magnet or something, like I couldn't pull away, until he ordered me to leave. I can't explain it. You don't need to explain, I said softly. Even here, among aliens, Alfangor was the hero. You asked what I'd swear by. I'll swear by him, by Prince Alfangor. And so I told Tobias of my plan. Chapter 13. E.T. Phone Home. When I found that sentence in Cassie's book of human quotes, it surprised me. To be honest, it almost scared me. It was as if it were written just for me. I thought maybe, somehow, my human friends had discovered my plan and written it there. From the Earth Diary of Aximili Escaruth Isthil. The sun was just coming up over planet Earth. I performed the morning ritual, as I always did. But I was especially impatient this morning. I knew Tobias was hunting a morning meal and would be back soon, as he had finished eating some unfortunate mouse or shrew. Freedom is my only cause, duty to the people, my only guide, obedience to my prince, my only glory. When Tobias returned from the hunt, we would go. He would lead me to the observatory, to the great radio telescope, and, with luck, I would be able to call my home. I, Aximili Escaruthistil, Andalite warrior, offer my life. With my stock eyes, I saw a hawk swoop low overhead. Tobias rested on a branch. He focused his fierce hawk's eyes on me. Are you done? Yes, the ritual is complete. Great, because it is a beautiful day for flying. Thermals like you wouldn't believe. And a sweet little ground breeze for easy takeoff. Tobias, you understand that you don't have to do this, I said. There may be danger. Yeah. Come on, Axe. Let's go already. I often go flying with Tobias. The bird morph I have is called a Northern Harrier. It is a type of hawk, about the same size as Tobias's red tail. Tobias's feathers are mostly brown and light tan, while the Harrier's are mostly gray and white. I controlled my excitement and worry and focused on making the change. The Harrier morph is always strange. For one thing, there's a great difference in size between an Andalite and a bird, even a large bird. The first sensation was one of falling as I shrank rapidly. My stock eyes went blind and wings grew out of my front legs, which is very awkward. It causes me to fall forward onto the ground, since I cannot stand on my hind legs alone. Besides, my hind legs were busy shriveling down into tiny yellow scaly bird legs, and my tail was shrinking and splitting into dozens of long tail feathers. Harriers also have mouths, like humans, only these mouths are useless for speech, and have very little ability to taste. On the other hand, they are wonderful natural weapons. They are razor sharp and curved down into a ripping, tearing hook. And the talons are excellent. I had long admired Tobias's use of his talons. He can swoop fast and low, just a few feet above the ground, and snatch up a mouse or a small rabbit with those talons. As I watched, the blue and tan fur of my own body was replaced by silver-gray feathers. The fur melted away to show the underlying flesh, and then the flesh became patterned with the millions of individual ribs of feathers. I was used to the mind of the Harrier, so I had learned to control its instincts. Its instincts were more forceful than those in the brains of humans. I've been meaning to ask you, Axe, Tobias said. Not to diss you or anything, but why is it that Cassie is better at morphing than you are? I mean, you're an Andalite. Plus, you look just as creepy as Jake or Rachel when you do it. Cassie has talent, I said a little grumpily. Morphing does not happen to be my talent. Oh. You ready to fly? I checked. I opened my wings to their full 3.5-foot spread. I flicked my tail feathers. I focused my laser-like hawk's eyes on a far distant tree and was able to see the individual ants crawling up the trunk. I listened to the forest with the Harrier's superior hearing. I could hear the insects beneath the pine needles. I could hear a squirrel chewing open a nut. I could hear Tobias's heart beating. I turned into the breeze and opened my wings. I flapped several times and lifted my legs clear off the ground. The breeze caught me, and I was off. Even with the breeze, I had to flap hard to get as high as the treetops. Tobias was already several dozen feet above me. But then Tobias has had a great deal of practice. I slept just above the treetops, flapping and soaring. The sun was beating down on the treetops and heat waves were rising. I caught the updraft and shot higher. I was 200 feet up in just seconds. I could see Cassie's farm now, and as I circled to use the updraft for more altitude, I could see all the familiar landmarks, the homes of the others, the mall, the school. Stick with me, Tobias said. We'll follow the water's edge. The observatory is north along the coast, about an hour's flying time. We reached the ocean. There were cliffs along the shore, and here the real thermals rose up. A thermal is an updraft of heated air. Flying into one is like flying into an elevator or drop shaft. The updraft catches your wings and lifts you up and up and up. It is a fantastic, giddy, wild feeling. I wheeled and turned to stay within the thermal, following Tobias higher and higher. We want to get above the gulls, Tobias instructed. Sometimes seagulls get obnoxious. They'll swarm a hawk if they're in the wrong mood. It was exhilarating. We were thousands of feet above the ground. Down below, humans lay on the beach, wearing less clothing than usual. Clothing is a strange human habit. They must wear it all the time. Except at the beach, when they may wear less. I don't understand this. The World Almanac had no explanation. Although I did know that the United States imported $36.7 billion worth of clothing. Keep an eye on that guy up there, Tobias said. What? Where? I asked, shaken out of my dreamy thoughts. A peregrine falcon. He's probably looking to pick off a few tasty seagulls. But he may decide we look more tender. He's small, but fast. Mean, too. I decided to keep an eye on the falcon. Earth is a dangerous, wild place. At least, if you're a bird. I thought it must be terrible sometimes for Tobias. He lives in fear of things that no human would need to fear. He has lost his position at the top of the food chain of Earth. Hawks are predators, but they are also prey. Yet he seemed to have accepted his fate. Was it possible he even preferred being a hawk? Was that why he never asked me what I might know about him being an offlet? Or did he think I would refuse to answer? Or worse yet, lie. Fortunately, the falcon ignored us and we flew on, following the coastline. Soon we had left the city behind. The beaches were gone too. The coastline grew more rugged, with waves that crashed and explosions of foam against jagged, broken rocks. A single road wound along the coast below us. There were cars on it, but few buildings. Then, in the distance, I saw a large white structure. Actually, several structures. There was a tall building with a dome top, and arrayed around it in various positions were several large white flattened bowls. It took me several seconds to figure out their purpose. "That's the radio telescope?" I laughed. "You're still using dish arrays? Won't they work for whatever it is you're doing?" Tobias asked. "Oh, yes, they should work. If I can gain access to the computers, they should work very well. It's just that they're so primitive." "I don't suppose you want to tell me what we're doing, huh?" "Doing? We're flying," I said. "Very funny. Suddenly you have a sense of humor. Great." Chapter 14. "The large building with the dome?" I asked Tobias as I swept above the observatory. "Is that where the computers would be?" "Maybe. That's where they have the regular telescope, I think. But they may have the control centers and computers there, too." I looked with my incredible hawk vision. There was a huge rectangular opening in the top of the dome. Inside, I could see a vast circle of glass. I laughed in recognition. "A telescope? An actual optical telescope? What can they possibly believe that will show them?"
"It will show them a redtail and a harrier flying around together, looking like lost tourists," Tobias said. "According to Marco, this place isn't really operating yet. So I don't know how many people will be around, but we need to find a place to land so you can morph into something useful and do whatever."
"Tobias, is that sarcasm? The way you asked me what I'm doing?"
"No, it's not sarcasm. I think it's called being snide."
"Ah, thanks for explaining. Why not fly straight into the dome?" I asked.
"Why not?" Tobias agreed. He led the way down.
We dived at high speed, rocketing down through the air. The brilliant white dome rushed up at us. I shot through the open rectangle and banked sharply right. It was much darker inside than outside.
Below me was the incredibly long tube of the telescope. I see doors down below. Those are probably offices, Tobias said. They'll probably have computers in all the offices, if we can find one that's empty. Yes, that would be good, but I will need fingers. For whatever it is I'm doing, I said. We circled swiftly around the inside of the dome. As I flew, I kept expecting to see humans below, but none ever appeared. This place is awfully empty, Tobias said. Yes, it seems almost abandoned, I agreed. Tobias, I'm going down. My morph time is running short. Now is when I should go on alone. Yeah, gotcha. Good luck, Axeman. Whatever you're doing, be careful. Tobias swept up and out of the dome. I was alone. I drifted down towards the floor, down and down to land on a table. There was a computer console workstation, but no humans in sight. I saw an open door leading to what seemed to be a dark and empty office. I flapped my wings twice and was inside. Harrier eyes, like hawk eyes, are adapted for daylight. They are not very good in the dark. But the Harrier also has extremely good hearing. I dimly saw a desk and came to rest on it, and then I concentrated on listening. I was alone in the room. I was certain of that. The only human sounds I heard came through the walls. Conversation. I could not make out the sounds, but they all seemed to be concentrated in one area. Axe, can you hear me? It was Tobias. His thought speech was faint. Just barely, I answered. I'm outside. I'm looking a window here. I see Ben in a room. Like some kind of meeting? Yes, I can hear them, I said. Can you keep watch over them? Let me know if they come this way. Yeah, if any leaves the thing, I'll let... Tobias said. I can barely hear you, I said. I'm going to morph. Can't very well, but go. My plan was to morph to my normal Andalite form, then quickly move into my human morph, just in case any human saw me. But I was tired from the flight, and morphing is very tiring, especially quick morphing. And if I had to make a quick escape, it would mean passing through my Andalite body to move back into the Harrier. I would never be able to handle that many changes in a short time. I decided to risk staying in Andalite form. Besides, if it worked and I reached my home, I wanted my parents to know me when they saw me. I began the demorphing. I can only hope that Tobias would be able to give me enough warning. Even though I loved being a bird, it was a good feeling when my tail began to form again. An Andalite without a tail is just sad. And no matter how powerful a hawk's eyes may be, they can still only look in one direction at a time. As my stalk eyes reformed, I breathed a sigh of relief. I could once again see in all directions. There was no computer in the office. I was very annoyed by that fact. It meant I would have to go back into the observatory to use the computer there. My hooves slipped on the polished floor. I swung my eyes in every direction, keeping a sharp lookout. I pushed the chair away from the computer workstation. I began typing on the antique keyboard. The screen asked me for a password. Password? I laughed. I disabled the security system and confirmed that Marco's father's new software was already in place. Good. That would make it easier. As quickly as I could, I wrote in a virus that would swiftly transform the software that controlled the radio telescope. Since humans had no awareness of zero space, they did not understand that a powerful radio receiver could be tuned in such a way as to create a Z-space vacuum and open a cross-dimensional gateway. Once I had opened a small hole in Z-space, it was child's play to use the same receivers to modulate and reflect the background radiation into a coherent signal. The hard part would be using thought speech to control the signal. That would take absolute concentration. Still out here, Tobias said. I hope the one word I couldn't hear was okay. It took about 10 Earth minutes to adjust the radio telescope. 10 minutes, and I had moved human science ahead by a century or so. 10 minutes to completely violate Andalite law. I was done. The system was ready. I pressed the enter key. The thousands of lines of computer language disappeared from the computer's screen. The screen went blank. I focused my mind as sharply as I could. I pictured the coherent signal. I pictured that beam going through my own head. Andalite home, I thought. Andalite home. The screen flickered. A face appeared. It was a hard, suspicious face, but it was an Andalite face. "Who is this?" the Andalite demanded. "This is a high security link. You are not authorized sender. State your name and location." "My name is Aximili Escaruth Isthil, brother of Alfangor Serenial Shamtul, son of Nuorlin Serenial Koraf, and Forlay Escaruth Mahin." The Andalite stared at me. "Alfangor's brother?" he wondered. "What is your location?" "My location is the planet called Earth.